everyone, I am here with author Varsha Adusumilli, who is feeling very shy right now, talking to all of you. Thank you, Varsha, for overcoming your shyness.
Thank you for having me.
And being a part of this. Varsha has recently written, published a book called Wonder Girls. And it is doing phenomenally well, which I hope this is just the beginning, and I hope this is just the tip of the iceberg that you're seeing now, because this book needs to be a revolution. Like, in this country, like, I'm becoming like militant patriotic about this. Like, I want this to do that well.
Thank you.
So yes, I will talk to everybody about the book, and ideally I would have already talked to you all about the book. So we will just jump right into it. I know you mentioned this in your introduction, but about how you had the idea for this book, and I'm tempted to summarize it, but I love hearing you tell the story. So can you tell everybody how you had the idea to show this?
First thing, I'm a big fan of your YouTube channel. I think you should make that a revolution, right? And then we make Wonder Girls also a revolution.
Yeah.
So coming to the backstory of the book, I think it's very important because the book came out of a personal experience, mm-hmm. right? So I was at my best friend's wedding in Jaipur. And I was dressed in my South Indian attire, and as a result, I was looking very different from my friend's cousins and her relatives from nearby places, right? So these kids would come up to me and talk to me, like, you know, start asking me questions, mm-hmm. because they were very curious, who is this strange person, right, hanging around here. So they would come up to me and say, Didi, how old are you? I'd say 27. And they would say, Didi, are you married? And I'd say, no. They're like, why are you still not married?
Yeah.
Are your parents not worried? Are they looking out for you?
Is there something wrong with you?
Yeah. Something like, they didn't say that, but I know.
Implied. Yeah.
How much money do you make? You came all the way from Bangalore to here in a flight. You went abroad, blah, blah, right? So this happened for the first 2 days, and I would answer all of their questions. But by the end of it, sort of, we became buddies. And at that point, they would come up to me and ask me different set of questions. So this time, their questions were not driven by the societal expectations, but rather driven by their own innate curiosities, right?
Mm.
For example, they'll say, Nidhi, I really want to become a dentist, but my parents want me to get married next year. How do you think I should go home and talk to them to not do that, right? One of the girls came and asked me, Didi, I really want to get an internship in Bombay or Delhi. Can you show me how to write a resume? Where can I apply online, right?
Mm.
So to me, that was an epiphany, wherein I said, you know, the very moment these young, you know, women, young girls, saw somebody who was relatable to them, somebody who was just a step or two away from where they are in their journey, then they also get the courage and the conviction to say, sure, I can do it too, right?
Right.
But rather, if you showed them like a far-off role model, like a Marie Curie or a Frida Kahlo or, you know, whoever else, right? They're saying, I mean, Jesus Christ, she's from a different planet, I can't even relate to her.
Yeah.
But if I showed them you, they'd say, how can I also make YouTube videos, right?
Yeah.
Or how can I act? How can I become a product manager? So that was the genesis of the book. And I came back from that wedding and I said, in my own network, I had access to so many people. So I said, why don't I put together a book that actually captures career journeys of millennial women, who are all pursuing diverse careers, and they also come from diverse backgrounds, right? So that's how Wonder Girls began.
So I actually think that's really important, because growing up and going to an all-girls school, and my brother went to an all-boys school, I think the all-boys school alumni network was so much more well-established. It felt like they were, you know, there was like the Rahul Dravids of the world, there were people starting their own companies, there were entrepreneurs, scientists, and it's like, there were no equivalents of that for an all-girls school. Like, maybe we had like one national level swimmer, like one, you know, domestic sandalwood actor, something like that. Like, it was very few and far between. So when I was reading the book, all I could think of was my 14-year-old self, and how if I had known then, if I had had access to stories like this, how different my life would have turned out. So like, I could go on about this, so I will not.
Thank you.
But thank you for writing it. I guess the next question, you said that you mentioned that you source these stories from your network, but how do you go about doing that? How do you narrow down the list of people? How do you extract the stories from them? How did you take this from idea to book?
So you're an engineer, right?
Yes.
Me too. So
yeah.
So I did stuff that all, you know, like methodical people do. So I basically began the process by writing a plan and a proposal saying that this is the idea, why will it work, why is the time right for it, like all of that usual stuff. And I basically did a quick search and I said, these are all the careers or professions in which people could have jobs. Right?
Yeah.
And I actually gave, circulated that sheet to a bunch of my friends and I said, do you know anybody who's a doctor? Do you know anybody who's a bright engineer? Do you know anybody who works in Bollywood? You know, do you know a stand-up comic? Do you know a poet? And on and on and on, right? So introductions actually started pouring in like that. And however, I do want to say that these are like your Didi's next door, right? The women I profile in the book.
Yeah.
So there could be a million such women out there already.
Yeah.
But I was sort of, I was sort of limited by what I could get access to, or I was, I don't know, limited is probably not the word, but I chose them because I had access to them. And when I called them and I spoke to them, their journeys really resonated with me. And I said, it's worth telling this for those young girls that I met at the wedding, right? So that's really how I went about picking these women.
Yeah, that is amazing because I think it goes back to your original point about you don't want to showcase just the one in a million. You want to showcase someone who is maybe five steps ahead and not someone who's beaten all the odds and, you know, gone from, you know, repairing shoes to winning an Olympic medal, because again, that becomes unrelatable to the average you know, Indian girl. I think that's incredible. I also really like that you've focused it around Indian women specifically, because again, when you're reading biographies, you're reading these incredible stories online, there are always people in different countries doing very different things who have access to opportunities that, you know, girls here might not have. So again, just so grateful.
Right.
So like, squealing.
So adding to what you've just said, there's a school in Pune called iTeach School. So they have six schools in Pune. And we juggernaut shipped them about close to 1,000 copies, I think. And they are teaching Wonder Girls as part of their curriculum, right? So they're teaching Wonder Girls to illustrate possible career choices for both men and women. They're also using it for topics like gender sensitivity and women's empowerment and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
And also just role models in general, right?
Yeah.
And one of the feedbacks that I get consistently from the teachers is that, thank you, because they're all Indian.
Yeah.
And they're millennial. And as a result, our students, high school student, feels like, huh, this girl from Pune who's become the captain of rugby team, we relate to her.
Yeah, right? She's a real person.
She's a real person. And she also went into the classrooms, by the way, and that was a big hit.
Yeah.
So, that's happening.
That's amazing. Because, again, I just keep going back to my childhood and about how, you know, I didn't even think that being an actor was a real job possibility. So I really like that even in the book, you've collected stories from, from scientists and lawyers and surgeons, but also from, like you said, artists and painters and poets and all of these people who are beating the, for lack of a better term, rat race to go do their own thing. And I feel like it is so important to make that clear that that is an option. If you are inclined to art or poetry, you can do that, because at the end of the day, the doctors and lawyers and engineers come home to watch movies, they listen to music, they read books, and who's doing all of that?
Right.
You need people who are doing all of that.
People like you.
And you. So I'm glad that this is actually, you know, like, it's taking off. So you were talking about school kids, right, and how this is doing really well at school, and I think that's one thing that I really liked about the book, was that you chose, I think, to keep the language really simple. So what was your target audience in mind when you started writing it?
So by design, I was actually writing the book for the girls I met at the wedding, right? And I thought my target audience would be somewhere between 14-year-old to even 30-year-old.
Yeah.
Because when a 14-year-old is reading the book, they're saying, oh, wow, I mean, I can become a Bollywood casting director. I can work on all these movies, still make money, have a life. Or I can become this neurosurgeon, which is very hard to do. And it's a rare profession, but you know what?
It's possible.
Somebody like me has done it, right? Whereas when 20-year-olds read it, they say, oh, wow, there's camaraderie. We have sisterhood now. I mean, there are other people like me. A lot of the readers come back to me and say, when I read the chapters, I realize I'm not alone.
That's exactly how I felt.
Yes, right?
Yeah.
So, and even when, before the book launch, I thought that's my target audience. That will be the people that we will, you know, push the book to. But something more interesting also is happening, which is that parents are loving the book. And they're saying, wow, I mean, it's amazing because we don't have a pulse on that generation. But when I read these stories, I get a sense of what they're thinking, what they're feeling, what are their points of view. And as a result, we can understand our kids better, right? And in fact, when I do the book events, the people who come and buy like 2 dozen books and 1 dozen books are moms. They're saying...
They're gifting it.
They're like, this is for my kids, but you know what? I have a dozen friends. I want to give a copy to each one of their kids, right?
Yeah.
And it happens practically at almost every event. And to me, that's surprising.
That is amazing. Like, I can't wait for like a 9-year-old to like be clutching your book in her hand and go up to her parents and be like, I want to be an aerospace engineer. And if they say anything, she'd be like, this person did it, you know? I'm like really looking forward to that generation like rising and making that change. So
Thank
about
you.
The first person perspective, so you biographed them and you still chose to do it in first person. Was that challenging to write it as someone else?
The reason why I wanted to do it in first person is because when you're actually sitting next to somebody and you're telling them your story, if you're a role model, you're telling them your journey, you do it in first person, right? And that was really my experience at the wedding, and I wanted to recreate that in the book as well, right? So that's why I was very intent on doing first person. Now with the interviews, I've interviewed 25 people and, 15 made it to the book. Some people are very if somebody is media trained, for example, the RJ, she's media trained, right? So when you interview somebody like that, you're wrapping up the interview in maybe 2 sittings and maybe 6-7 hours done. And you have everything that you need and you can see how you want to do the chapter from start to finish, right?
Yeah.
Some are not, in which case, or some are very shy, they've never been asked these kind of questions, they don't know how to answer them.
Yeah.
So in which cases, you're probably spending 20-25 hours just on the phone or in person or on Skype, whatever, trying to get what you want to get out of them, right?
Yeah.
And then I would sit with these 50 to 100 page transcripts. And I would look at them, read them, and go spend some time with myself saying, what is the chapter that I want to write out of this transcript that I have? And what made my life easy was that because I was tracing their career trajectory, it is a biography, it's a mini biography, but I was specifically looking at which points in their life sort of made their careers the way they are today, right?
Yeah.
So having that clarity made my life, made my life easy. Of course, doing it was hard work.
Yeah.
But having that clarity made me understand what is this chapter that I want to write on each one of them, right?
Yeah.
Because I had that clarity, maybe it didn't bog me down that much, but of course it took the hours.
Yeah, that's incredible. And you did this with 25 people, right? How long was the entire writing process for you from the time you started sourcing the introductions to your final draft?
Yeah. So I think the first draft was written about 6 months.
Okay.
And after that, I did a couple of rewrites on multiple chapters. And there's also a back and forth with my editor she doesn't like a chapter, she doesn't want to put it in, and we are fighting. There's drama, and I'm sending her 20 emails back to back, and my editor responds with one word, no.
Oh my God. Yeah.
No.
And that's why she's the editor.
That's why she's the editor, and I'm no, 500 words. And one day she sends me a message, I love reading your long emails. And I'm like, sure, this is the longest email that you've ever sent me. It's just not a yes or a no, right?
Yeah.
So I did rewrites for about 3 months on specific chapters. Some chapters sort of wrapped up faster. And I think after that we went through the copy editing and the line editing process, which is also hectic, right? It's not that easy because you have multiple people looking at it, they come back with queries, you have to go back to the girls and clarify that, and you have to show them the final drafts and then see that everything is properly aligned. So maybe 9 to 10 months.
Wow. I'm so glad you did it, because your 9 to 10 months, I feel like, is gonna translate to a century of changing women's experiences. I know I sound like this fanatic fangirl, but that is really how I feel about this book. When I was reading it, I mean, I could understand a little bit of how much you must have worked to extract these stories from these people, because, I mean, not everyone's a writer, so you can't just be fill out this form and send it back to me. You have to talk to them, you have to write it yourself and all of that. So I was stunned, first of all, the amount of effort that you put into to put this book together. And also,
You're making me
I
feel
was
so
crying,
good.
Dude. I was like crying. Like I would be sitting in the cab and I would finish reading the story. I'm gonna go back to like
yes,
me passionately. Like I know I sound like this fanatic fangirl, but like that is really how I felt. Like I would be reading this book in a cab and I would have to stop at the end of the story and just let myself cry it out for a minute and be like, this is what women are missing. Like forget women, this is what girls are missing. This is what we're missing in our lives, is this idea, this example. You know, I remember reading so much again from a different country, different context about Michelle Obama and how representation matters and how like young black girls now believe that they can also be Harvard, Stanford law graduates and go on to be, you know, the first lady or be the president.
Right.
And like again, that is a one in a million story, but like for me and this book, it was like this is everything that I want every little girl to read.
Dude, meet me every day.
Yeah.
You make me so happy.
Yeah, like this book makes me so happy. I think this is Sure Shot has like leapfrogged so many books that I have like been very attached to because this has made such a big difference to me. And I'm already 27, I've already gone through my career change, I've already struggled with these thoughts myself. I can't imagine how much easier it's gonna make it for someone else. So
thank you so much.
I just
much.
Keep circling back to this, but like thanks for writing it. I know it was 10 months of effort, but I'm really glad that you put it in.
Thank you.
I guess I'm just tempted to ask now, and I know it's hard to pick a favorite, so I won't say favorite, but which was the story that you sort of resonated with the most when you were doing all of this?
The easiest ones were the nerdy ones, because nerd to nerd, you always,
yes.
You know, I mean, I think as a, you know, as a person who was narrating somebody else's journey, the hardest ones were actually the ones who are not like you,
yeah.
Right? The, you know, the non-engineers, the non, you know, math students, from a writer point of view, that was hard for me to do.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I actually enjoyed all of them. I know everybody says this. But to me, I'm just fascinated by how somebody who grew up in a place like Soren, which is a village in Sikkim, you know, sort of comes to Bangalore, and by the time she's 30, she discovers a new species of an animal called a pika, which is a type of a rodent which you find only in high altitude regions of Himalayas, And how does somebody do that, right? And when
yeah.
you meet this girl in person, she's like maybe 4'9", or you know, like, you know, tiny little character. She's a wonderful human being. And you would look at her and you think, this is the girl who's doing expeditions in Himalayas? I mean, I won't believe it.
Yeah.
If you came and asked me, Varsha, think of a, you know, scientist, me being me, despite that, I would close my eyes and think of a dude from IIT Bombay, right?
Yeah.
But this girl actually debunked some of my own myths. It's close to my heart.
Yeah, that was one of my favorite stories also. I remember, I think so many of the things that she said in, I'm saying it because I read it in first person, right? So she says that people don't believe her when she says that this is what she does. And it's heartbreaking that we are so conditioned to believe that the scientist guy is, you know, mustachioed, salt and pepper haired man from IIT Bombay, that we don't even consider that someone who looks like her could be a scientist. I think
yes.
it's heartbreaking, but also at the same time, it's heartwarming that she is doing that.
Yes.
She's changing the narrative. Like, I know something as simple as, you know, I used to ride a motorcycle, like, which usually only guys ride. And even that was such a frustrating experience that people are like, oh, you ride a bike, you're too cool. Like, I didn't imagine you would ride a bike. And I'm like a 5'9 man-sized, you know, like, large individual. And they still have a hard time believing it. So I can't imagine what she must go through every day.
Yeah.
And again, that's why I think, like, representation matters so much, is that you need to be able to close your eyes and visualize anybody.
Yeah.
Not just the
True.
Salt and pepper haired man.
True.
So again, next question I'm tempted to ask, is there more Wonder Girls coming up? Like, are you making this a series?
Dude, let's have some surprises, no?
I'm just hoping and waiting. I really hope that it does become, like, I would love like an encyclopedia of Wonder Girls. That would be so amazing.
You are a Wonder Girl.
Hey guys. Shy skin. That's awesome. Okay, so I won't push further on that question. Let me see if there's anything else I had in here. Yes. Now, I know that at the end of the book, you've put together a section of like sort of summarizing some of the things that all of these women had in common and how as a young girl, you know, you can take it forward. Do you have any advice for a young girl today who is like, I really don't want to do science, I want to do commerce, but people think that choosing commerce is like, because I'm not smart enough, I can't do science, that's why I'm doing commerce, but actually she really loves commerce. Like, just with that as an example, or with anybody that wants to do something that's other than what is expected of them, like, what would you tell that girl?
Yeah. I think the good news for me, which is that when I interviewed all of these women, I mean, what I've learned is that you can actually make things work, right? For example, the RJ that I featured, she always wanted to work in Bollywood as something, right? And she couldn't do it right out of college because of pay, and she wanted to get paid, so she chose to become an RJ. But once she started doing that, she cultivated a side hustle. Where she's figured out a way to get involved in Bollywood, right? Mm-hmm. And today she hosts a show called The Film Companion. And it's quite a popular one. I mean, some of her videos get a million views or whatever.
Wow.
That's powerful stuff, right?
Yeah.
So it doesn't really have to be, I mean, it doesn't even just have to be, okay, I don't want to do this, or let me only do that, right? If your circumstances for some reason don't allow you to do only this, and do this then, but figure out a way to integrate some of this into your life. Make
right.
it a side hustle. Test it out and see if it's working. Iterate on top of that. And once you prove to people around you that it's working, you know, there's no reason why you couldn't do that full time, right?
Yeah.
So be practical, and you can be resourceful and make things work, right?
Yeah.
So have people around you that support you. Have tools around you that sort of aid to your life. And invest in yourself. Invest in yourself, even if people are not believing in you. Invest in yourself. And the things that I've also learned by interviewing these girls, it is that, sure, maybe 10 people don't believe in you when you go and talk to them. But you just need to find one or two that do, right? And when you find that one or two that do, that's enough for you
yeah.
to keep going, right?
Yeah.
So don't give up. Find them. And there will be those one or two who will really invest in you
yeah.
and support you. That's about it.
Yeah.
And read my book.
Yes. I really like that you said it doesn't have to be one or the other. You can do both. You can manage the practicalities and
yes.
you know, the passion. And I really like that.
Yeah.
Now on the flip side, you said find people who support you. Like, if do you have any words for parents of young girls and how to support their daughters?
Yeah. I was actually surprised, right, when I met all of these people. I mean, I interviewed 25, but I also met a lot more whom I did not interview but spent time with, and so on and so forth. It's surprising. I don't have any data to back this up. It's just anecdotal. It's surprising how important the role of supportive parenting is, right? A lot of these girls actually have parents who've invested in them, send
yeah.
them to extracurriculum, send them to decent school, whatever it is that they could afford to, right? The rugby captain's dad took her to playground every morning, right? Even though he wasn't sure if it would pay at all or not, he did that, right? The visual artist dad, I mean, mom and dad, they bought her a computer because they saw that she's, you know, interested in graphic design or whatever it is. And I'm not saying the support is 100% there, and because there's a generational gap, there are some things that you may want to do, but your parents don't agree, and there's always that tussle which
yeah.
actually comes out in the chapters. But net, they've been supportive, right?
Yeah.
And that's my, you know, that's my, not even an advice, because I don't think I have the data or sort of that kind of a backing to say this, but at least what I've uncovered in my chapters is that the parental support is everything.
Yeah.
So invest in your kids and support them.
Yeah.
When you disagree with them, then disagree with them, but support them in the places where you need to support them.
Yeah. I think that's amazing. I think, and again, this, if it's coming across like gyan, I don't want it to, because both of us have switched careers. Both of us have talked to people who've switched careers. We've seen it, again, anecdotal, but we've seen the impact that it can make in someone's life. And so this is real. This is not a concept. This is not a utopian idea. Like, I get a lot of people who are like, oh yeah, you lived in America, so you're one of those feminist types, so you have a skewed idea of how the world works. No, this is not that. This is real. These are real people who've had real success stories.
Yeah.
And they have also had failures before their successes. And I think that's something that I really like about, I think you mentioned Nilparna Sen, who's a gym trainer. And she talks very openly about the struggles that she had before she became a trainer and before she started doing what she's doing. So that it doesn't have to be something that clicks when you're 14 or 15. It can be
yeah.
when you're 27, it can be when you're 40. But if you want to do it, you can.
Yes.
And I think that was my biggest takeaway from this book, was that anything that anyone tells you that tries to that is limiting you should just be like flushed with toilet paper down the drain.
You are the chief ambassador for my book.
Can I get a gold star?
Sure. I'll get one made for you.
Yeah, thank you. But yes, thank you again. Thank you for taking the time. The time to write the book, the time to put all this together, the time to talk to us, the time that you're taking out to make sure that your target audience meets the girls who are mentioned in the book. And I hope you continue doing this and changing lives.
Thank you so much. Right. And I do want to say one thing, which is that I know that you do your acting stuff and your theater stuff and everything, but I'm such a big, big fan and admirer of your YouTube show. I think it's so real and so honest. And there are sometimes I just open, you know, Urvashi's channel just to see what she's up to, and I just laugh my heads off because some of that stuff is so real and so well made.
Thank you.
That you should just take it to the next level.
So thank you, Asha. Awesome. All the best. I'm really excited to see what's coming next, and I hope that somehow someone somewhere makes Wonder Girls into like an encyclopedia. So yes, this book is available on the Juggernaut website, on Amazon, in bookstores. Everywhere. I will put a link in the description to the Amazon and the Juggernaut marketplaces where you can buy the book. And yeah, Vasha is here. She's a real person writing about real people who are doing really incredible things. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
Have a nice day.
Thank you.